series called Breakthrough. And because everybody I'm around has some stuff going on. There's something in their life, and they're all unique. Some are a little similar, but most are unique. They are desperate for God to move. Some of them have settled there. They have settled where, I guess I'll just always have unmet needs. I guess I'll always want in this area, okay? And so some people don't know what Scripture says about their situation. And so you just kind of settle, right? But most people need a breakthrough. They're really close. We've already been reading in this series alone, being maybe just one step away from a breakthrough. So what we decided to do was just kind of to leverage that. Hey, if that's where everybody is, one way or another, let's go ahead and make that a normal place to be, like, but not a permanent place to be. It just means you're waiting in line for a miracle. It means you're waiting in line to go to the next level, right? And that God responds to our obedience, okay? So if you're in a place where maybe spiritually you've been lacking, you're in a place where you've lost your spiritual edge, things just don't hit you as hard anymore, right? Maybe it's been a long time since you've been on fire for the Lord. Maybe it's physical needs that you have, like you don't have enough to do anything different than what you're doing. And so we're going to kind of leverage Scripture today, because every conversation I get into, it seems like people are saying their story. One was this week, I just jotted them all down. One was a guy that was so desperate financially, he doesn't know how he's going to dig his way out. He doesn't have a solution. He doesn't know how it's going to get any better. Then I paid attention. The second person I talked to this week that I just kind of, for my own illustration, it's a single mom of three kids. And she's already working a full-time job and cleans two houses on the side. And she doesn't know how she's going to make it. She's one step from homelessness. She needs a breakthrough, right? And then I talked to a 14-year-old kid who just kind of found myself talking to him. We were waiting in the same line. And his parents, they just told him that they're going to be divorced. There's no way to reconcile. And so he felt like, man, I'm being torn because one wants me to be their favorite, and so does the other. And I just don't know what to do. I need something to happen. I don't know. So a lot of breakthroughs are needed as I look back, as I interact with people. So we're going to dive into this text in 2 Kings chapter 4. And we're going to start with two verses to kind of give us some context. And then we're going to learn how to experience a breakthrough, right? We're going to learn that being empty kind of qualifies you for God to do something in your life. Some of us fill ourselves up so much with things and stuff that we're never empty so that God can pour in, okay? So we're going to learn how to have experience a breakthrough. And this is what the Bible says. This is how the story starts. It says, the wife of a man from the company of prophets cried out to Elisha. Elisha was a prophet, a man of God, somebody that spoke on behalf of God. You knew he was connected to God. So would listen and speak as God. So it says, your servant, which is my husband, is dead. He died. And you know that he revered the Lord, but now his creditor is coming to take my two boys as his slaves. So that's the story so far, is your servant, he was one of the prophets, and he's dead. We don't know how he died, but he's dead, and she is in a jam. She needs a breakthrough. She's financially destitute, and the creditors are coming to ask for their debt to be paid. And Elisha replied to her, how can I help you? Notice his words. How can I help you? Tell me, what do you have in your house? Your servant has nothing at all, she said, except a small jar of olive oil. Your servant has nothing there at all except a small jar of olive oil. So we're going to look at what the jars are and what the olive oils are. And the first thing you know about this encounter is that we don't know her name. We don't know this widow's name. We just know her situation. And according to Jewish tradition, everybody assumed that this is a prophet called Obadiah, which was very good to other prophets. He would take from himself to make sure that other prophets had their needs met. So what that implies is they were kind of already living paycheck to paycheck anyway, because he was so generous and thoughtful of other people. And so now she's in a jam. So if you can picture this, she's probably around in her early to mid-30s. She just lost her husband, and because she's a woman, she's unemployable, right? Unless she had one resort, which shall not be named, that was the only other option, was to give herself out, right? And she wasn't going to do that. And so she's devastated, and it doesn't seem like it would get any better than this. No hope whatsoever. And for some of you, you attach yourself to that. I feel hopeless. I'm not sure my situation is going to improve. And I hear a lot of lower level problems that we have, right? I started jotting them down, and one was, you know, we get upset, right? It's a problem when our GPS doesn't tell us to take the right turn, right? We can get pretty upset about that. I was at work, and we all ordered something, some food. They brought it back, and this lady, I thought she was going to have a fit because the biggest problem in the world, they put too much goat cheese on her salad. And one that I heard of, I'm not saying it was me, but here's a big problem. The last time I was in Target, been sitting there a while, and I looked over, and there was no toilet paper. And you have that little mini heart attack when you're like, okay, what the heck just happened? Who is responsible for this? What do I do? So I thought about calling corporate line right there when I was on the toilet to see if they'd get somebody to come bring me something. Right? But, wow, I just thought of this. A little bit can go a long way. Remember, I just came up with that, and that's going to be so significant later. A little goes a long way. And a lot of us have little entry-level problems like that, right, that we think are a big deal. But when we think about maybe this encounter, we see that this is a big deal. And here's what I've realized is so many of you do have that next-level problem, big problems that you're facing. Some of you are in a financial situation where it keeps you held hostage. You can't think about anything else. You don't make moves for God because you feel like, I just can't, and my thoughts are dominated. I don't have room to think about anything else other than my financial situation. Some of you have children that are really taking a wrong turn. And you know you've lived life long enough, the decisions that they make, where that leads to. Those are big problems. Some of you, your marriage is barely hanging on. It's on the ropes. It's struggling. That's a big problem. Is a jet about to take off back there? Another one is some of you, your spouse is not coming around. They have walked away from Jesus or just haven't got on board. And you see the problem with that down the road, right? And so many of you are dealing with major things that makes you feel like you are empty. It makes you feel like that you need a breakthrough. And so the scripture is going to point us in the right direction here. And this is kind of the big idea. When you don't have what you really want, you will discover that God is what you really need. Yeah. I'll say it one more time. Not just for a clap. I told you to pause. Write it down this time. But when you don't have what you really want, you will discover that God is what you really need. That's where we get to. And so we're going to unpack this story from this point and see what happens. Let me tell you the first thing he doesn't do. He doesn't say, oh man, it stinks to be you. That's not what the prophet says, Elisha. Right? He makes himself available to her. And I think it's difficult to watch people when you say, oh, I'll pray for you. Or you're in my thoughts. That's what I like. I'll be thinking about you. I want to say, don't think about me. Pray for me. Right? Move the hand of God for me. Right? And so Elisha replied to her. He said, how can I help you? You made yourself available. And he said, how can I help you? He didn't claim to have all the answers, but he said, here's how he started out. What do you have? I hear you say what you don't have and what you need, right? But if you're going to experience a breakthrough, what do you have already? What has God already given you? What is already in your life? We're going to start with what you have. Right? That's where he gets to. And so we know this concept where people are, when they don't think they have enough, they kind of dwell on that, okay? Their view is kind of skewed. I don't know any women like this, but I think you do. I've heard some of y'all talk about this, is when they go look in their closet and they say, I don't have anything to wear, but they got everything to wear, right? When we need a breakthrough, there's a tendency to focus on what we don't have. And so as we start to move through a breakthrough in your life that's unique to you, is listen, we got to recognize there's a tendency to focus on what we don't have. That's a pretty slick scheme by your enemy, is to make you focus on what you don't have. And that's where this woman is, and she starts to kind of look at everything, and her assessment is, I don't have anything, right? And this goes back to this. If you're taking notes, God is famous. He's famous for a lot of things, but one thing he's famous for is doing a lot with a little. So the whole target thing makes sense now, right? That's what he tends to do all throughout Scripture, just to give you some encouragement, just to give you some inspiration, is to, when you assess things, what has God given you? And even if it seems like a little bit, listen, God is the one who makes it a lot. Over and over in Scripture. So in 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 2, he starts with this. He said, what do you have in your house? She says, your servant has nothing there at all except what? Except a small jar of olive oil. So olive oil is actually incredibly valuable. When you go look at it, you go research it for yourself on all the things that it was used for. Number one is cooking. That's always good, right? Pastor appreciation. Just cook me something, right? Steaks, lobster, anything like that. It was used for cooking. They burned lamps with it, so it actually gave light, right? And it was moisturizer when you got dried out, when you got maybe sunburned or maybe hurt. They would rub it on there because the Bath and Body Works, the nearest one was hundreds of miles away back then. And they used to keep leather. Leather would get dried out, and so they'd rub it with oil. It would preserve leather. Things that you use, your little satchel and all those things. And it would keep iron from rusting, right? So every time we look at what is olive oil used for back then, that's why it's so valuable. And then they would use it for religious reasons as part of their services to anoint people with oil. When you read about that, it was very, very valuable. And so she says, I don't have much at all, but I do have a little bit of oil. And so, I don't know if you, I say oil because I'm from Gastonia, oil. Some of y'all say oil, right? Popeye's girlfriend, olive oil, olive oil. So, all throughout Scripture, we see God take a little bit and make a lot out of it. And one time there was this, in Scripture, there was this, in the New Testament, Jesus was out teaching. And people were there all day long. And people's stomachs started growling. They were there so long that they had skipped some meals. It's getting late. And somebody says, how are we going to feed all these people? Right? And somebody says, we don't have any food. But a little boy, they found out a little boy had a little bit of food. Turns out they fed thousands of people with some left over. The Bible says they have 12 baskets of fish and loaves, basically fish sandwich, basically Filet-O-Fish. Have you noticed how much those cost at McDonald's? They're like $4 a piece. I don't know. Right. So, who whistles for Filet-O-Fish? In the Old Testament, there was a whole army that was afraid of a giant that had descended upon them and was bullying them. And the whole army was shaken. And it took a little boy, right? A little boy to pick up a little rock and to beat a giant, right? So you see how God uses a little. He picked up a little stone and put it right in the middle of his eyes, right? And killed a giant. And then one time Jesus was teaching to his disciples, people that were trying to follow Jesus. And in his teaching, he found out that, we find out that a little bit of faith goes a long way, just a little bit. And Jesus actually said this in Matthew 17:20. You don't have enough faith, Jesus told them. I tell you the truth, if you had the faith even as small as a mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it would move. Nothing would be impossible. So we serve a God that can do a lot with a little. And all throughout Scripture, again, it's what do you have in front of you? What's available to you now? And Jesus even asked in the Old Testament, God asked Moses in the Old Testament, he says, what do you have in your hand? Because Moses felt unprepared to take the next step where God had called him to. He said, well, let's start with this. What's in your hand? He had a staff. And so God tends to do that for us. And so if you're feeling like, I'm waiting on something else. I'm waiting on more money. I'm waiting on another job. I'm waiting to be obedient, to take my next steps. And the Bible's screaming at us. It's saying, listen, start with what you have. Right? Give glory to God with what you have. And the second thought we learn from this awesome story is offer God what you have and trust him to give you what you need. Okay? Start with what you have. Is Tiger Woods in here? Because those are golf claps. I'm just kidding. It's worth clapping for. Because listen, God loves to fill empty things. He's got a pattern of that. It's part of his character when he sees something empty to fill it up. Watch this. Watch this come true in 2 Kings 4:3-7. Elisha said, listen, here's what I want you to do. This is the man of God speaking. This means instruction through a man of God. Right? Elisha said, go around and ask all your neighbors for empty jars. Go get some empty jars and don't just ask for a few. What he's saying with that is prepare. You have a great need. You really do. It's a hopeless, seemingly hopeless situation. But I want you to prepare for abundance. So in the middle of us needing a breakthrough, God wants us to prepare for abundance, for his provision for us. It's not that it comes and then we have a breakthrough. We're Christ followers. We say we believe in God. So after a while, you start to get familiar with God's character. And he wants to prepare. That shows faith. When we prepare for God's blessing, it demonstrates our faith. Right? So Elisha's saying, go ask everybody you can, all your neighbors, anybody you know, and don't just ask for a few. Ask for all they got. Because God's not just going to provide what you need. He's going to give you more than you need. And I wanted to stop here just to give a little thing. I wrote it really this morning. I don't know if it's going to come up on the screen. God has prepared other people to have what you need. God has prepared other people. Right? You have a need, but he's already been preparing people to help you meet your need. That's why we press down on community. That's why one of your students, maybe a couple, were talking about community. The importance of gathering and knowing people intimately, right? To try to be a part of a body of believers. Because you're going to have need one day. And part of God's plan for you to have a breakthrough involves other people. Maybe it's words of encouragement. Maybe it's a straight up resource that you need. But Scripture's not playing around when it says how important community is. I love it that you're here on Sunday. My prayer, believe me, is that you're here every single time that the doors open that you possibly can. Not just for our sake, but for yours. Because we know you're going to need a breakthrough. If you're not right now, you will. And something about it is going to involve other people. So if you're in need of a breakthrough, that's important. In verse 4, it says, then, after you ask for all these jars, then go inside and shut the door behind you and your sons. So just you and your boys. Pour oil into all the jars, and as each is filled, put it to one side. So what's going on here? They got a bunch of jars and a little bit of oil. Put that jar aside. Every time you fill one up, use the jar that you've got the little bit and just start pouring. Just start pouring. And this sounds like a ridiculous instruction. And here's what I want you to get, man, is you're going to get it when you come to me and you ask me, hey, man, you're kind of like, you're my pastor. And I've got I need a breakthrough in my life. I'm going through some things, okay? The response may be not what you want to hear. right? It's going to be from Scripture, but it sounds, that sounds too crazy. That doesn't match my scenario, my situation, right, to do that. I need a breakthrough. You don't understand. I do understand. Here's what God's called you from Scripture to do, and it's always crazy. God does that. He always works in unconventional ways to provide us with a breakthrough. So that's exactly what happened. In verse 5, it says, she left him and shut the door behind her and her sons. Then they brought out the jars to her, and she kept pouring. So she's going to experience a breakthrough because she followed what God had told her to do. As crazy as it sounds, that guy says, look, I'm just a messenger, but here's what you need to do. And listen, you wouldn't believe how many people don't do what God's called them to do to experience a breakthrough. They lean on their own strength. They lean on their own understanding. They lean on their own hustle. And they continue to struggle and be frustrated. So when I say, man, when you serve God, I love that our church benefits from it. But listen, here's what I know is that it provides for you. It offers a protection for your marriage that you can't even comprehend. There's something about serving. When you give, it's not taking more from you, and everybody, your debtors are coming to your door wanting your kids, right? And how am I going to be obedient in my tithing? I don't know. There's something supernatural about it. God's got the best plan. It's better than your plan, right? So things don't make sense. They don't make earthly sense. But she didn't take a chance. She said, my breakthrough is so needed. I'll do anything. If you told me to rub peanut butter in my hair, I'd do it right now. You just tell me what to do, God. And she did. That's why that scripture seems to repeat itself. He says, this is what you do. And the next little bit is exactly what she did. So in verse 6, it says, when all the jars were full, she said to her son, bring me another one. But he replied, there is not a jar left. We've used every one we could get our hands on, and there's not one left. And the Bible goes on to say, it was then, when there was no more empty jars, that the oil stopped flowing, that the valuable thing stopped flowing is when they ran out of jars, right? So as long as there was an empty jar, God would fill it. That's actually the application point. As long as there's an empty jar, God will fill it. That's good news. If you're on empty, if you're struggling for a breakthrough, you need some movement in your life, I feel like I'm empty, then you're in a really good place for God to do something. So look for his instruction. Realize it's going to be a crazy instruction. It's going to be something that doesn't feel like it matches your scenario. But if it's from God, or somebody that hears from God and he's already prepared them for you, if your breakthrough is bad enough, you'll do it. All right? I need a breakthrough, so I'm looking for instruction. Because obedience is the first step towards a breakthrough. If you need one, you need to look for the opportunity to be obedient. What can I do right now, Richard? What are some things I can do? Right? Maybe that's something you need to come to the blue room after we're done and talk about. What are my next steps? Here's my situation. It's bad. You've read the Bible a little bit. I'm sure God's prepared people here. There's people that work in the blue room that serve. God's prepared them to meet a need, a spiritual need, a physical need, a resource. Right? So let's find out where you are. Verse 7 says, she went and told the man of God, and he said, here's the good news, go sell the oil and pay your debts. Your debt has been paid for. You and your sons can live on what is left. So here's the way God works, if we do it God's way. When we're obedient, when we're listening for his instruction, and we follow it, God's goal is not just to meet your needs. This is awesome news. It's to meet your need and then some. Prepare for abundance. God wants to blow your mind. He wants to give you not just what you need to get by. He's a generous God. He's a loving God. And he wants to give us more than we need. He said, look, you and your sons can live on what is left. Live on it. That means you don't have to go to work. Your sons won't be slaves. And just that alone, man, if I missed that point, is your obedience affects other people. Look, they weren't coming to get her. They were coming to get her sons. And they were going to be in slavery until the debt is paid off, or the year of Jubilee. Every 7 years they would forgive debts. That could have been 7 years away at this point. So the urgency on her, maybe the urgency on you for your breakthrough, effects of the people, maybe other people's life is impacted one way or another, depending on how you respond to the crazy instruction of God. He just wants our obedience. He knows what you need. And he wants to meet more than just your need. When we show God our faith, we get to see his faithfulness. God wants to see our faith. He wants us to believe it will happen. He wants us to not just believe it in our head, but to show our action in our life. That's how Christ follows. If you're new to this, if you're contemplating on entering into a relationship with Jesus, God wants our faith. The Bible says it's impossible to please God without our faith. So we live our life assuming God's going to come through. We plan it. We don't overextend ourselves with our time, with our money, and all these things, because God will provide for us. He knows what we need. Here's the deal. Your emptiness, you being empty, makes you available for use. Kind of go a little different direction. So some of you are full. You're full of just your time is slammed full. You don't have time for one more thing. Right? You are full of things. You've planned it out. Your time, you've got your things around you to do and stuff that you have. But sometimes those things take up space. You need to empty yourselves. The Bible says that God uses empty vessels, and the vessel's not just a ship. It's anything that holds anything. God uses empty vessels. That's why when we walk away, when we repent of sin, we walk away from it, right? We empty that out of us. We empty pride. We empty ourselves of these things. We make it where we can be filled by God. Where we can be filled. Listen, we'll talk about jars for a minute. The only requirement for that breakthrough that we read about this morning is that the jars be empty. All right? They need to be empty so they can hold something. That means you have to pour something out. You have to take something out. It didn't matter how big they were, what color they were, how old they were. He said, get some empty jars. Because God has a way of filling empty things, right? I didn't put this on the screen for sure. It's 2 Corinthians 4:7, and it's in the New Testament. And it says that we have this treasure in jars of clay. Which means when we're in Christ, we have this treasure that is in us. It's saying that we are vessels. We are clay pots. We've been molded and shaped by God to be empty so that we can be poured into. Because here's the symbolism in this whole thing is oil or oil, wherever you're from, is a symbol of the Holy Spirit all throughout Scripture. Oil is used to describe the Holy Spirit. It's used in those religious ceremonies, right? So God wants to fill us up. But listen, if you're already full of things, some of you need to empty yourselves out. And you do that by, if you're preparing for a breakthrough, it's like, I need God to do something in me. And the next step you have is to empty yourself. Now, there's people in churches all over the world today that are using this as an altar, the front of their stage. Someone turn and face plant in a chair. Some do it right where they are. Some go to another room. And they talk about it, have a dialogue with God. God, there's things in the way. I'm so full of things. I'm full of anger and hurt and pain. And God, I need you. I need you to empty me out. Because when you're empty, you prepare yourself for what God has for you. And it's awesome. It's full of abundance. But some of you are held so tightly to things. You didn't know you were supposed to be empty. I don't know if you've seen this. It's on YouTube. How to Catch a Monkey. There's a baboon in wherever it was, and this guy in the village, looks like some African village, made a hole in like a side of a hill, just enough for the baboon to stick his hand in. He put some sweet treats down in there. You seen this? And the curious baboon goes after he walks off. And the baboon comes up and reaches in there to get that. And he grabs a hold of it. And he's trying to catch this monkey. And what happens is, he reaches in there, gets his hand full of the stuff, and tries to pull it out. But he's so greedy, right? The greed is so deep and the want is so much that he can't let go of what he's got a hold on to. And this guy from the village is just over in the bushes, and he walks over, and the monkey's going crazy, but he will not let go. And he enslaves him. He puts a rope around his neck, and then, too late, then the monkey drops whatever was in his fist so his hand can slip out. But he's already enslaved. Man, I feel like, man, that so many people I see, they've got their hands so full of things, they need to empty them. Their hand is so full, man, their schedules are crazy. And there's no room for God. There's no room to be obedient. There's no room to take steps because you're not emptied out. So that's what I want today to be about. Listen, your response to be. There's always a response to the gospel. No response is still a response. Some of you need a breakthrough, and you need to start, listen, with a relationship with Jesus. He wants us to surrender our life. He wants us to repent. That means to empty out. It means to turn away from what you were doing. It says, you know, I don't have, up to this point, I don't have room for God because I filled it up with all these things that have nothing to do with God. So God wants you to empty yourself, so that he can pour into you. Some of you, listen, I walk around believers that are constantly running on fumes. Church and ministry seems more like a job than a joy. And then when you talk in their life, they are so full of other things. And you don't want to be the jerk to tell them, hey, this might be where you need to let go so you can hold on to more what God has for you. They haven't reconciled that there is sacrifice. It's not your sacrifice. Your sacrifice is just in response to Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. But as the pastor, as the person that's supposed to be connected to God, I'm far from perfect. But can I say from you lovingly and humbly that there's some things to let go of. There's things to empty out of your life so you can experience. You can't fill up something that's already full. Sometimes we're just full of the wrong thing. I want that to really hit home so that it will free you up. This is not to burden you. Jesus said that he came so we could have freedom. And what he meant by that statement is that he knew we'd be enslaved to things. Things would dominate us physically, emotionally, financially. He wants us to be free of those things. So what today's response would be is just a emptying of yourself. What is it that you're so full of that you need to empty out?